Kwe, Nina Louise, Suzanne, which is Kali Migmagi. Hello, my name is Suzanne Patles. I told you guys that I sprout from Migmagi, which means that I sprouted up just like the blades of grass, but that's how connected we are to our land and our territory, is that we believe that we came from that land. So in saying that, I'd like to acknowledge my presence here, and I know that most of the time the presence here is acknowledged under the treaty number, but I'm so decolonized at the moment that I acknowledge the ancestors that are buried beneath our feet, beneath this concrete, which is Anishinaabe. So I'd like to acknowledge that we're here on Anishinaabe territory. So I'm sorry for those of you, if you get offended by me not acknowledging the treaty, I'm sorry, but this is how I've come to acknowledge the territory that I'm standing in, because I'm just a visitor, and this is what we all are, we're all visitors here. So I've been traveling all across. I went to British Columbia. That was initially, I was only supposed to go to British Columbia, but then the Prairies called and they said, we want her here too. And then Ontario called, and so my trip got extended. So it's my honor and my pleasure to be here to come spread our message of Indigenous resurgence that we have experienced in our territory and that we continue to experience. First of all, everybody describes the fight in our territory as a fracking fight, but it's bigger than that. It's a revolution in its own way, where we're trying to emancipate our nation from the colonial chains of oppression. So our fight with fracking as the Mi'kmaq Warrior Society, you usually hear of the Warrior Society fighting for their fishing rights in Burn Church, fighting for our timber rights in the forest, at Big Hole Track. You hear of us at the front lines of all of these different battles. But our battle took on a different approach when the threat came to the water, when the women of the society decided that this is what needs to be done and we need to make a stand. So back in 2010, we decided that we were going to take on an oil company called Petroworth Resources, which was going to come to the part of the territory known as Unamagi, which is in Mi'kma'ki territory, because our territory is so big, we have different sections within our territory. So we decided to dispute against this company and assert our title over our land, our inherent rights and responsibilities to take care of our mother and to protect her from encroachment and protect her from these companies who want to come and rape her. So we decided to make this stand, and the oil company came out to the community, and basically we didn't back down. We didn't let this company president talk, and we didn't allow him to try to say that the benefit to our nation was a couple jobs. Basically, his life was threatened, and he was told to get out. And after our long, hard battle, we were having ceremonies to make sure that our water's protected. We were having letter campaigns, phone campaigns, all of this different fight. We didn't actually have to go toe-to-toe with this company or with the RCMP, but we made them broke. And they weren't going to come back into our territory. So it came, another company was trying to encroach and threaten our territory, which everybody knows the name of now is SWN Resources, Southwestern Energy. So they decided to want to come into our territory, and the Mi'kmaq Warrior Society was asked to come to the community of Elsipogtog. And so when we got there, they were already starting to mistreat our people, where they broke a woman's arm. They were throwing youth into vehicles for saying, you know, don't touch my mother. And there was a lot of different things happening. So I went up there to go assess the situation and to see if we could come up with a strategic plan together to be able to defeat this company, or to at least have small little wins here and there. And that's what people don't tend to focus on, is the small wins that you're able to accomplish when your boots are on the ground. So when I got there, I decided that we're going to actively help this community out, and because this community was coming together, where it was a beautiful sight to see, because the entire community of Elsipogtog was coming together for one purpose. They were no longer having any infighting. They all had a common enemy, and it was a beautiful thing. So we decided that we were going to focus on the sacred, where there was a sacred fire lit, and then there was an encampment built around that fire where people were able to come to a centralized location so that they could come and have a place to be on the land, and they could come and have a place where they could talk and come to consensus on what they were going to do to defeat this company. And it wasn't only Indigenous people, it was supporters and allies. And supporters and allies are two different things. Allies are the ones who are going to get beat up right beside you when the cops are coming in. Supporters are there who are going to make a Facebook status about it. So there's this clear distinction, and everybody wants to be an ally until there's time to do some ally stuff. And that day stuff went down, we had two. We had two allies, which, you know, I very acknowledge them, and I honor them for being there for us on that day. So in saying that, my first arrest, I was charged several times over the summer, and I was an outstanding citizen. But I was born into a family of resistance. So my message is always, we need to create a culture of resistance where resistance becomes normalized, because all far too often, oppression is normalized, where we're used to being oppressed and we're used to living in fear. And I was fortunate enough to be raised by a family who aren't going to put up with the oppression and are not going to put up with the oppressor coming into our territories and telling us what to do. It started with my hearing stories from my grandma. I was raised by my grandma, and I call her mom, which is my dad's mother, because we tend to carry on that tradition where the grammy is raising the babies, or the grandparents is raising the babies. So we held on to that tradition closely, which is why I'm able to have that support, to be able to have my boots on the ground, because the grandparents are taking care of my babies, because I have two. So my mom would tell me, my Grammy, she would say that she didn't go to Indian day school because she refused to go. She'd rather be at home with her grandmother, learning from her, traditionally, learning to be Olnu, which is who we are. So, and then I asked her, you know, why didn't you go to residential school? And she was like, because my father, she said, when the Indian agent came knocking at the door, he pointed the gun at his head and he said, if you come and take my children, I'm going to shoot off your head. So that's the kind of things that became normalized in my family. Resistance is normal, where I'm going to stand my ground and I don't care if everybody else is doing it. I don't care if everybody else is allowing this. I'm not going to allow it because I was raised that way, because we're not going to put up with it. So if once we normalize resistance, then we're going to be strong enough to stand up against the oppressor. So that's, everybody always wonders, well, where do you gather your strength from? It runs in my blood, it runs in my family, and it could still happen. We just can't allow fear to live over us, to have that veil over our eyes to make us oppressed, because fear is a symptom of oppression. And once we allow that fear to encroach upon our lives, then the enemy is starting to already win. And this is what they tried to take away from us in residential school. And this is what they tried to take away from us when they introduced alcohols into our communities, when they're introducing these drugs, when they've done all of these things to our people. They've been making our people cry for 522 years, and it's about time it stops. So on June 9th, I was arrested for praying. So it brought us back 50 years where it was illegal to be Indian once again. And I got thrown into jail, and I refused to talk to them. I wouldn't say a word. And they held me over for court the next day. And they decided to put a condition on me, 5 kilometers from any shale gas testing or exploration. I yelled at the judge from behind the bulletproof glass, and they reduced it to 1 kilometer. I still wasn't satisfied, and I was really upset at the so-called defense team that I had, which was legal aid. And I said, I'm not going to let them represent me because they're not going to do what I want. I didn't want this condition, and they didn't fight it. So I decided that I was going to fight for it myself. Because upon arrest, my first time they lifted me up off the ground while I was praying, I told the officers that I was sovereign and they had no authority over me. And they were stunned. They weren't used to somebody saying that upon arrest. But after a 5-month battle in court, I didn't even plead. They dropped the charges, because they knew they had a hefty battle on their hands. I threw a status card down at them. Then they told me that they were instructed to not consent to my Aboriginal descent, So I decided to throw my status card away. I threw it away, so now sometimes I kick myself in the bum because I'm like, oh man, I could have used it at the Indian store, but oh well, didn't work. But it doesn't really matter anymore because I know who I am and I don't need that card to validate me because they're just not going to allow me to use it if I try to use it in court anyway. They'll be instructed not to. So after them not being prepared every time I presented my case in court, I thought it was ridiculous and redundant that they weren't prepared because they've been going to school for this. They've been fighting so-called criminals every day in courts, and yet they weren't prepared for a little Indian woman who was standing her ground and telling them what her rights and responsibilities were, because I learned their system. I learned how to dismantle their system, and I knew my responsibilities, and I knew my oral traditions, and I was able to braid those to protect me. So after I was arrested, and I had these conditions on me, which was June 9th, so June 14th, there was a wave of arrests of allies and Indigenous people were arrested for trying to stop these vehicle dumper trucks from coming in to test in our territory. And this is all it was. Basically, people would be like, well, I can't believe you guys were trying to stop them from testing. Well, that's the first step. Because if you don't start stopping them at the testing phase, then you're going to have to deal with the rigs already in the ground. So on June 14th, there was a wave of arrests. And then on June 21st, where normally all across Canada, for as long as I've known, Indigenous people have risen, and they would stand up on that one day. They would use that one day to stand up and to assert who they are and assert their responsibilities. And that day, the women decided to do that. And when they did that, one of them was 8.5 months pregnant, and a few were elders. And they arrested all of them. They punched the elderly woman in the mouth, and there was blood coming from her face. They headlocked an elderly man, which was her husband. And then when I went to go pick these women up at the police station, the pregnant woman was released practically right away. But one of the female officers told her that she was to get comfortable and prepare to have her baby in jail when she's never even had a criminal offense in her life. So basically they were using psychological warfare against her and against our people to try to manipulate them into thinking that they've done something so wrong that they're going to be held up in there for a really long time. So things moved on into July, and the thumper trucks were off the road, and they had these drillers in the woods where they're drilling down 15 meters, putting dynamite into the ground and linking these up to and exploding them off in our hunting territory to gather data. So the struggle was happening in the woods in our hunting territory. And things heated up when the community of Elsipogtog, they have Sundance ceremonies every year. And one night out of the ceremonies is the ghost dance. And we decided that since this company wouldn't agree to stopping their testing while their Sundance was going on, we were going to take ceremony to them, and we were going to call out the ancestors on them. So it was the first time the men, we called in the men because things were getting too heavy. It was the first time the men of the Warrior Society and the community were working together. And when they were working together, they were able to successfully stop this truck for 8 hours and while we're negotiating with police to try to get ceremony happening up there. But they wouldn't let any of the pipes in, they wouldn't let any of the drums in. So they were already arrogating and negating our rights out there. And after 8 hours, we finally decided to let these trucks go. But the women who stayed at the camp, because all of our members went down to go take showers and to get, like, we figured that the workers are gone, they're not going to come till about 7 a.m. and this was about 4 a.m. So we're waiting around for this company to come back, and we didn't hear any word. But then we got a phone call that the women were raided up at the camp, that their drums were taken, their feathers were taken, their flags were taken. So we went up to confront the RCMP. We had about a 10 parade car, our caravan. There was 10 cars in there, and our warrior chief told me, get in my vehicle, because the cops were always harassing me. They were punching my vehicle, pulling my vehicle over, throwing things at it. They were really crazy. So he said, get in my vehicle, and they're not going to touch you. So I had a bunch of warriors in my vehicle, and I was like, oh, they're going to be surprised, and they know it's not me in there. So I was in the warrior chief's vehicle, and it was following right behind mine. And we just passed by this barricade where there was two cop cars coming together. And we passed by that one, and we passed by the other one. So they were now following us. doesn't his engine blow? And I was like, oh no, what are we gonna do? And then I said, man, we have chains in my truck from last night when she tied herself up to the truck. So let's chain her up. So we chained her up and then we kept going, and my truck was going through so much because of everything that was happening. I had no muffler on there, so it kind of sounded like an 18-wheeler. So we weren't really surprising anybody going up there. It was just going, like really crazy. I was kind of giggling this whole time. I was like, this is so crazy, because once we chained it up, we had all of our warriors on top of the trucks on the chains to make sure that it's holding. So it probably looked crazy. A bunch of Indians in camouflage in a caravan hanging out the windows, hanging on top of the car and hanging off of these chains and in between vehicles. And it was really crazy. So when we met up with the police, there was confrontation there. And then we had the Canadian Army on the line. We called them and we told them, you tell these police they're not letting us into our hunting territory and things are about to get serious. So they let us through, and they cleared up their blockade and they let us through, and the looks on their face were priceless when they seen that my truck was chained up to this other truck, and they were just like looking in stunned. They were stunned. So they were so stunned, and the company was freaking out so bad that they left. They left and they said they're taking a summer break, that they had enough. And that was a success in itself. They're only supposed to take 4 to 6 weeks off, but they end up taking off for about 8 weeks. I think they were scared of when they were gonna start working. But the women of the, so during this time, while all of this was happening, while they were taking their summer break, we decided to stick around and to create unity with all of the other people who are outside of the community of Elsipogtog, to reach out to non-Indigenous supporters and allies and to forge together to create that greater force. So it was about 8 weeks of lobbying and working with people and visiting them and hearing their struggles, because one of the things that they're worried about is if their water is gone, then how much is their property value going to be? So that's one of their concerns that they had. Not only were they worried about the water, and not only were they worried about the future, but when you can only think about economics, they were worried about how much their property was going to be worth and that it was, their value was going to decrease. So it'd go from like a $500,000 home to a $5,000 cottage. So basically, we were working towards getting these unity and attending meetings and going to these different avenues to gain support. So during one of these times, the men were attending a meeting, me and my spouse went to go nosy, because Indians are nosy and you always want to check something out. And so we went to go nosy what these women found. They found a compound. And we were like, well, I wonder what's in there, because we've seen all of this equipment all summer. We just wanted to know if all of the equipment was in there or if it was only some. So when we ran into the woods, I got a text message that the cops now blocked off the road, and this was now September 28th. So the company was already gone for about 8 weeks. So at September 28th, the cops blocked off the road. Things were starting to get heavy because the cops were arguing with the women who were there. And I called the men up and I was like, hurry up, you guys got to get here. They locked me in. They locked us in here and they're going after the women here. So when the men showed up, the cops quickly retreated back to their blockade areas on the west and on the east. And we decided, well, since the cops directed a blockade, we might as well have a party. So we stuck around, and since they weren't going anywhere, we weren't going to go anywhere. The road is blocked, nobody's using the road, so we might as well use it for our own benefit. It's, after all, it is our territory, even though there's concrete there, or asphalt, whatever they wanted to call it. So as time progressed, we had gatherings after gatherings at our site. Yeah, trees were knocked down, but we needed firewood. And they were trying to deem that as an unlawful protest because there was trees getting knocked down. We told them that it was our right to do so. We can cut down any tree we wanted to because that was our right. We needed that warmth from that fire. So after a long time, they asked us, what rights do you guys think you guys have to be here? That's what the cops asked. So we presented them with a piece of paper with a list of our basic words, Aboriginal rights, treaty rights, sui generis treaty rights, Aboriginal title, you know, all that legal jargon. We threw that at them and they were pretty stunned, you know, they're like, I can't believe Indians came up with this, you know, looking at it. So then they wanted a bit more. So we decided to have a list of 13 demands that we wanted from the federal and provincial government. We were demanding documents. We already had all of these documents. Why would we know about them if we, you know, but anyway, we were demanding to see these documents, and these documents delegitimized the authority of the provincial and federal government. So we had the cops send a copy to the premier, and they told us they sent it, and we expected a response. Little did we know the response was going to be a raid. On October 17th, when we woke up that morning, the cops came in with their guns drawn. A lot of the imagery that was seen on the media, on Facebook, social media, what have you, was imagery from the outside perimeter, which was the East Gate, I believe. One water? No. And from the East Gate, they were blocking the community members from coming in. And it was only the Warrior Society members who were on the inside of the camp. And all of that stuff was the cops trying to stop them from getting to us, stopping them from coming to see what was going on. So the confrontation between us and the police lasted for about 2 or 3 hours, where there were some live rounds shot, there were some less lethal rounds shot, and there were... what else did they do? Oh, and then they basically kicked us and punched us and all that stuff, but that's not a big deal. So after all of that happened, they arrested us on the inside, which was at before 10 a.m. And everybody sees the images of the cop cars burning. That was 1 p.m. The Warrior Society were already arrested. We were already all incarcerated. We were already all beat up by that time. So whenever that happened, that has nothing to do with any of the society members. I think it's the cops who burned it, because they never even charged anybody and they didn't even do an investigation. They just left them there. They left them there for days and days and days, and they did nothing to them, where people were climbing on them, taking photo ops and all of this different stuff. And if it was an actual crime scene, wouldn't have they taped it off and did a proper investigation? And when they were asked what was in their vehicles, they can't tell you which vehicles were burned or what was actually inside of these vehicles, when they're supposed to know what equipment they have, and the people who are driving it should know what vehicle they had. They should have their paperwork all lined up and their ducks lined up in a row. So on that crazy day of October 17th, as I told you guys, I woke up to guns. When I came out of the bush, there were guns there. I don't really talk about what happened on the inside, because we still have two political prisoners of war, and they both were there on the inside. And I don't want anything I state to affect their case in any way. But the thing I will explain is that I did get to upload one video from that day where I was yelling at the cops to get me out of their scope and that I only had a camera. But I was trying to upload a second video because there were several officers who gave us tobacco as an offering of peace on October 16th, the night before the raid. And I met one of those officers while I was on my trip here, and not here, but while I was in Edmonton, he was in the audience, and I was really upset that I seen him. He disturbed me, so I laid it out on him and told him that they're going to pay for how they treated our people out there, and that they were gonna pay even for unlawfully confining me, because I have no charges on me even from that day or any other incident this summer. So I told them, if our men aren't free, your organization is gonna pay the consequences. So after they gave us that tobacco, and the next day we woke up to guns drawn, and when I was trying to upload that tobacco video, all I heard was my spouse yell no. And then when I looked up, there were six officers there with guns drawn, and I was sitting in the passenger side of a van. And then they were all yelling different things at the same time, and then I just ducked my head down and threw my phone away and put my hands up, because what else are you going to do if there's guns pointed at your head? And then I heard a gunshot. It went through the windshield, and then the barrel went through the windshield, where they hit me on the top of the head, they hit me on the side of the face and in the back of the head. I got hit about 5 or 6 times by the butt end of an assault rifle. And then they started kicking me with their boots. And then the ERT members moved away, and then the officers in blue were able to beat on us at that time. But one thing I will describe from that day was the fact that when I was getting beat up, I was getting beat up side by side next to my spouse. It was kind of Bonnie and Clyde moment. We're both getting beat up by the cops. But one of the officers had their knees on top of his chest, and they were choking him, and they were telling him that they were going to kill him. And I actually did think that they killed him when I went into the sheriff's van, because I seen an ambulance come up. And while they were walking us up the road, they pulled him into the ditch. And that area is where the ambulance went. So I was freaking out. I was sitting in the sheriff's van trying to rock it, but I couldn't even budge it a little bit. It wasn't even like wiggling. And I was like, I guess it's not gonna work if I go crazy. So I'm just gonna sit down and yell. But then they weren't hearing me. So then when the officer came in the car, I said, did you guys kill him? Did you guys really kill him? And they told me no, that it was an ambulance for another woman. So I kind of calmed down a bit from that. But when I was released at about 1 o'clock in the morning, I wasn't released unless I had $500 bail. They said because I wasn't from their colonial border of New Brunswick that they were going to implement a bail. So I had to get bailed out right then and there. And I was telling the other women who were with me, I said, if you guys leave, they're going to beat me up again. So I was yelling out at the cell of the other women who were released from the other, they put us into drunk tanks. So the other drunk tank, even though none of us were drunk, I yelled at them and I said, can you guys get me $500 to get me out of jail? And I guess the cops thought that, you know, Indigenous people aren't going to be able to put up $500 because we're so poor. But in 20 minutes, the community of Elsipogtog put together $500, and then I was free. So we went back to the site, and when we got back there, it was beautiful to see that our people fought off the cops. It was disheartening to see that the trucks were gone, but it was beautiful to see that our people were still there, and that they still had the fires going, and that they fought off the cops until the night came. So we were waiting around all night sitting near these fires, slowly seeing people come back out of jail, getting released. And we're slowly trying to count how many, who's all in there. We're losing track of everybody because it was hard to figure out who was thrown into jail and who was being let out. So we're trying to keep track of all of this. So we decided, well, we're going to court. We're going to go to court in the morning, and we're going to find out who has a hearing. So when we got there, they released some of our men, but they kept six. So at that time, the following Saturday, which was the day after, because the raid happened on a Thursday, their bail hearings were on that Friday. So on Saturday, the community decided to take over the highway, to take over one of the main arteries, to show the government and to show this company that we were all still here, and that despite them incarcerating our men, that we were going to stand our ground, that we're not going to go anywhere, and that they still had a big fight on their hands. So we took over that highway for a couple hours, and this whole time, mind you, during all of this happening, there's airplanes circling this whole time. There's helicopters going by, and there's all of this stuff trying to distract you and trying to play psychological warfare on you, but you tend to learn to like zone it out. You don't hear them anymore, you don't see them anymore, and you basically don't care anymore because you know you're out there doing something right. So when my spouse called me from jail, he asked me what was happening, and I told him, well, we blocked the highway to show them that it ain't you guys in there that are the troublemakers, it's us out here, and they let the wrong Indians out. So he hung up shortly after, but unfortunately, they threw them all into solitary confinement for 3 weeks because of it. Where they were strip searching them every 2 to 3 days. It wasn't because they thought they had contraband, it was a form of punishment for standing up for their people and for being a warrior, because they wanted to treat them like terrorists, because that's what they want to do. And we don't care what they want to call us, they can call us what they will, and we're determined that we're warriors, and we're still going to continue on, even if they want to call us terrorists, even if they want to call us violent, and even if they want to deem us criminals. So from then on, we lobbied for them to be released from solitary confinement and for them to start being treated as humans. So we were able to lobby their way out of solitary confinement, but yet they were denying them their spirituality, they're denying them their medicines, they're denying them an elder to be able to come in. So late November, we were able to finally lobby to have an elder come in to see them. And when my brother Cody was released, he let me know about how they were being treated actually on the inside. Because there's only so much that you can talk about over the phone, and there's only so much that they allow into the letters. So when he came out, we decided to lobby for our two men who are still being held inside, because it went from 6 to 2. So now there's 2 in there, my spouse Jermaine Bro and my brother Aaron Francis, who are still currently being held and being incarcerated. So through fighting as hard as we did, and for them fighting as hard as they did on the inside, we were all fighting together on this, they finally now have smudge kits. We're able to change that system. We're able to change that facility from denying them to have them having them have access at any moment. Instead of them being thrown a Bible from the priest who's in that facility, to them being able to light a match and pray the way they want to. So it doesn't mean that you can't change anything, it just takes a lot of time and determination. So now we're going to try to get them, we're trying to get them a sweat. I was, earlier when everybody was eating, my spouse called, which is why I ran in there. I barely get to hear from him because I don't know when he's gonna get a phone call, so I had to find out if they even received money, because there was money sent from Vancouver that they didn't receive, and we're gonna have to get a lawyer to look into that, because they're withholding their money and they're withholding their letters and different things like that. So with all of those things that are going on, we're not only fighting the system, we're not only fighting the government, we're not only fighting this company, we're fighting to be who we are. This is what basically what it is. We're just struggling to be Indigenous. And this is what we're trying to assert. We're trying to assert our responsibilities. So it becomes very difficult when it becomes illegal to be who you are through policy, through regulation, through dispossession, and through outright oppression and systematic racism. So with all of this stuff that we were facing, it becomes a hard battle. It becomes a battle of where you're trying to actively fight a company, you're actively trying to fight this oppressive government. But as I realized as I traveled through here, that the battle is the same. We're all trying to stand up for our sacred responsibility to the water. We're trying to stand up for our sacred responsibility to the land. And the enemy is the government, because they're the ones handing out these policies. They're the ones handing out these leases and permits to these resource extraction companies that are coming in to poison our land and our water and poison our children in the future. So it's through us asserting who we are is where we got today. And when I travel all across, people are like, well, how can we support your guys' movement? How can we support what actively is happening? Well, if you want to really support, then you could, you know, support through the Legal Defense Fund. But you can also support by looking around where you are locally and what's the local Indigenous struggle there. Because Elsipogtog and Mi'kmaq territory is so far away that you don't have that real connection to it. Yeah, you see what's happening on social media. Yeah, you hear the stories. Yeah, you see it in the news. But what about what's happening in your own backyard? What about what's happening here? Why isn't there that much attention? Why aren't people lobbying together as much as they did? You know, when are we going to stop doing round dances and do it strategically? Make that round dance cost money. You know, you're going to put it at the port. You know, the British Columbia, they stopped ports and they stopped all of this stuff. And I was like, I was kind of in love with all of the Indigenous resurgence that happens there. I'm like, you guys almost sucked me in, I even told them. But that resistance culture is something that's embedded in them, because they're the last to meet up with the colonizers, and they stood their ground when they arrived there, and they've only been, you know, they've only met the enemy for so long. And in our situation, in our territory, it's been longer, but that resistance is still in our hearts. And I know that if it's still in our hearts out east, and we've met the oppressor long time ago, that it's still possible everywhere between my territory and British Columbia. It's still possible where that fire still could burn inside of everybody's heart. And those fires you've seen, those cop cars burning, those tires burning, that was the fire inside of everybody's heart in a physical presence. And it created great imagery and it created great media attention. But what it needed to do was to ignite the fire and resistance inside of everybody else's heart to say, you know what, this is enough. We need to stand up. We need to do more. We need to find out what exactly we're good at and to use that towards resistance. We need to find out what entertains us and to be able to use that towards resistance, because we need to create that resistance culture. We need to create this revolution on where, you know what, I'm gonna tell 10 people, and those 10 people are gonna tell 10 people. And we're gonna work it from there, and it's gonna build up, and it's gonna be bigger than anything we've ever seen. We need to stop, you know, being discouraged that, oh, we weren't able to create that change with Bill C-45 and we weren't able to do anything. But there's alternatives, and that's what people aren't thinking about. When they removed that legislative protection, people weren't thinking that we had the authority as Indigenous people to fill that legislative vacuum. We could fill it and be those protectors of that water. And people often ask, what's your message when you're going around? Well, my message is simple, warrior up. But if you can't, then take those baby steps until you get there. Go out and hold your sign. You'll get tired of it eventually. You'll want to take another step. And when you take that other step, you'll get tired of that too, and you'll take another step. Eventually, you're going to be running, and you're going to be running for your people, and you're going to tell them, come on, let's go, it's time. We need a warrior up. Because I had Granny standing on stage in British Columbia, crying out to the crowd, telling them to warrior up, and telling them this is the time we need to stand up, because if our water gets destroyed, then everybody else is going with it. Every other life form is going with it. We're at the, and they always say, we're at that point, we're at that crossroads. Either we do something good or we're going down bad. And I don't want to see our people go down bad. I don't want to see everybody go down bad, because this is a human issue. People like to say, well, it's an Indigenous issue. Well, it's the Indigenous people who are out on the front line, who are risking their lives, who are getting arrested and being criminalized for asserting who they are and asserting their authority over their inherent territories. And they're standing up and against a legal entity, which is corporate Canada. And right now, everybody's like, well, colonialism, that's what you said when they came to your shores. Right now, everybody's colonialized. It's just the only difference is everybody wore feathers. It's just a lot of people forgot about it. We've only been fighting colonialism for 522 years. Out in Europe, you guys were colonialized a long time ago. And you guys just forgot that you guys had to struggle with it. So when you arrived here, we had to slowly show that, you know what, this is not the way. Colonialism is not the way. Corporate colonialism is not the way. And when the Indian Act was developed, it was developed because of the resources, because they seen all of our trees, they seen all of our animals, they seen all of these so-called resources that they could take back to the motherland, to take back to make money. And it's still happening today. All they see is resources. These corporations, is all they see is resources. They're going to take and take and take back to the motherland, which is now their pockets. And that's all they're going to continue to do. And we're all being oppressed and we're all being colonialized by these corporations who are working hand in hand with the government to oppress everybody. So what we have to do is to unite together and to realize that we can only do this if we're doing it all together. And if we don't, then we're going to face impending doom. So I don't know how much time I have left, but I'm going to leave it at that. And I want to thank you guys all out for coming here tonight to come and listen to our struggle in our territory. And I hope that I was able to ignite some kind of resurgence or resistance inside of your heart, if not at least in your mind, to get you thinking about how you're going to play an active role in the revolution. So Walali off. Thank you.